my heart, acceptable in thy sight. O God, my strength and my redeemer. Amen. I think the best thing for me this morning is to go ahead and preach. Amen. If you'll join me in the Gospel of St. Luke chapter 9. Gospel of St. Luke, the 9th chapter. I'll begin reading with verse 51, Luke 9, beginning with verse 51. As you know, we're continuing in our series from Who Moved My Pulpit. And this morning, I want to talk about the church in transition. In the Gospel of St. Luke, the 9th chapter, verse 51, you'll find recorded these words: when the days were approaching for his ascension, he being Jesus was determined to go to Jerusalem. And he sent messengers on ahead of him, and they went and entered a village of the Samaritans to make arrangements for him. But they did not receive him because he was traveling toward Jerusalem. When his disciples, James and John, saw this, they said, "Lord, do you want us to command fire to come down from heaven and consume them?" He turned and rebuked them and said, "You do not know what kind of spirit you are of. For the Son of Man did not come to destroy men's lives, but to save them." And they went on to another village. And as they were going on to the other village, they came along a road, and someone said to him, "I will follow you wherever you go." And Jesus said to him, "The foxes have holes, the birds of the air have nests. The Son of Man has nowhere to lay his head." And he said to another, "Follow me." But he said, "Lord, permit me first to go and bury my father." But he said to him, "Allow the dead to bury their own dead, but as for you, go and proclaim the kingdom everywhere." Another also said, "I will follow you, Lord, but first permit me to say goodbye to those at home." But Jesus said to him, "No one, after putting his hand to the plow and looking back, is fit for the kingdom of heaven." As you're seated, I again want to talk about the church in transition. In our text, we see, my brothers and sisters, the disciples, the early followers of Christ, serve as a representative sample of the church. And so any of the behaviors, any of the things that we see them going through, good and bad, it is representative of the church. So as Jesus and his disciples are on this journey, we begin to discover that the disciples are very much like disciples today. They were literally allergic to change. Jesus here is really offering or bringing about some transition in his ministry. Because up to this point, Jesus has been primarily in the northern part of the nation of Israel, in and around the Sea of Galilee. Jesus was prophet, priest, king. Jesus, as was shared in the children's sermon, he had the greatest food ministry there ever was. He was the greatest physician that ever existed. He was able to touch tongues and make stammering tongues speak clearly. He was able to touch eyes and make the blind see. He was able to simply speak a word and make the dead rise from the grave. Jesus had ascended literally in popularity. As a matter of fact, he had amassed what might be called a mega church in Jerusalem. That mega church was based primarily on the fact that Jesus was doing a ministry of health. He was blessing folk. He was healing folk. He was feeding folk. But then there comes a transition in ministry. And when there comes a transition in ministry, we see that mega church falls to a minuscule number of individuals. Because Jesus says, "Listen, I want you to understand that was not my primary mission. Those were side things I was doing, but my mission is to go to Jerusalem." And we find that whenever the church gets in this transitional phase, many begin to fall away. And you'll find, my brothers and sisters, that many of us are literally allergic to transition. We want everything to be just as it always was. This is what the disciples are struggling with in this text. That's why they begin to come up with so many excuses, because you need to understand that if Jesus had continued doing what he was doing, no one would have come up with any excuses as to why they couldn't follow. Matter of fact, nobody had an excuse up to that point. They liked what Jesus was doing. He was blessing them. Now, Jesus brings about a transition, but it's really not a transition. He's saying we've really got to get to the core of why we really matter is, the church simply has to rediscover its core reason for being in existence. I know it's wonderful to feed folk. It's wonderful to do a nice community things. It's wonderful to be advocates for the community. But first and foremost, the kingdom must be preached. Till the Lord comes back. We want everything to remain same as it always was. Listen, a couple of years ago, there was a storm that came through Tulsa, and particularly hit North Tulsa really hard. And on our block, it blew out a transformer, and our lights went out. And I went outside, and I noticed that literally all the lights on our street, Young Street, were out, and all the lights behind us were out. And I began to wonder what was going on, and I realized it wasn't just us. There was some sort of a blackout. Not long after that, a city cruise and PSO arrived, and I discovered that what had been blown out that connected the whole neighborhood was really in our backyard. And so for a period of time, you were all without power, without lights. And when the power goes out, what do? You start to look for some candles and for some flashlight. Well, all of us have that drawer in our house, that drunk drawer. You know what a drawer is. That's where the flashlight is. That's where the candles are. That's where the matches are. You can get there in the dark. So my wife and I fumbled around looking for candles and looking for flashlights, batteries, and finally we found them. But as I was going to the drawer, I tried to flick on the light. Because I'm a creature of habit. Now, circumstances around me had changed, but I was still trying to do the same thing. Circumstances changed. The lights were out. And so I couldn't just flip the switch. I had to get light a different way. But then after we got the candles lit and the flashlight on, I grabbed the remote. And I wanted to turn on the TV. But listen, circumstances around us had changed, but I wanted to keep on doing the same thing. But then, since I couldn't get the TV, I said, well, I just turn on my computer. But I can't turn on my computer because circumstances around us had changed, and I couldn't keep doing the same thing. Well, listen, First Baptist, circumstances around us have changed. And we can't keep on doing the same thing. Somebody talk to me in this place today. It requires ministry in a different way. Listen, many of us get frustrated with all the construction signs, and that never ceases to amaze me, because we get on our politicians and our mayors. We want progress. We want to see construction. We want to see building. But the other night, we were trying to get home, and the northbound end of the dispersal loop on 75 was closed, and I had to go all the way around. I was frustrated because circumstances had changed, and I had to do something different. I see all these concrete mixers and all these cranes and all these new apartment complexes going up downtown, and Greenwood doesn't look like it used to look when I was a boy growing up. There are new buildings, and they don't build buildings like they used to build them anymore. They look modern. They look different than they used to look. As I thought about it, everything around us is new. But the church has stayed the same.
Come on.
Doesn't it want to change anything? But listen, there's modern around us, but we're still stuck in antiquity. The fact of the matter is, the message remains the same. Listen, my brothers and sisters, we got to change. Listen, in 1827, my brothers and sisters, you need to understand that there was a memo that went out from the management of Western Union. And the memo that went out from the management of Western Union in the 1800s was this: the telephone has too many shortcomings to be seriously considered as a means of communication. But Western Union discovered the telephone came. And we discovered not only has the telephone come, but the telephone has come, and we don't have landlines anymore. We've got cell phones. Somebody talk to me in this place today. And the fact of the matter is, it's going to come a point when your cell phone is going to be your remote. It's going to start your car. It's going to raise up and down your garage. Somebody talk to me in this place. The fact of the matter is, everything around us is changing. And we've got to change with it. In 1927, one of the brothers of Warner Brothers Studios said in 1927, "Who in the world wants to hear actors talk?" Can you imagine going to see Black Panther and it's all silent? Listen, circumstances around us have changed. And my brothers and sisters, the church has to change with their circumstances. Listen, we need to understand, my brothers and sisters, that the disciples here are struggling and trying to come to grips with the change that Jesus is talking about. And in order to come to grips with the change, the first thing they've got to do is to remember who brought them there and why he brought them.
Amen.
You know, listen, what often happens, and Tom Rainer says this, that churches all begin with knowing what the mission of the church is. But as time goes on, we begin to invert everything. When the church first starts, it's on fire to reach the lost. When a church first starts, it wants to reach its community. It wants to change lives. And 90% of its resources are outwardly focused. But as time goes on, most of the resources become inwardly focused. We begin to focus more on the members than on the folk out in the world that we're supposed to be reaching. It becomes about me, myself, and I, and not worried about them other folk. The fact is, we got to remember who brought us to this point. The Bible says that Jesus died on the cross for sinners like you and I. He reconciled us to himself, and he reconciled us to God so that we can be ambassadors of reconciliation. We've got to remember who brought us here and why. He spoke in this text, the disciples have lost sight of the fact of why Jesus came into the world. Lost sight of the fact of why Jesus brought them to the point where they were. Then also, not only did they need to remember who brought them where they were and why, they also had to resist trends and fads. Listen, when Jesus was talking about the institution of the church, he said, "Who do people say that I am?" Some said that you're Elias. Some say Jeremiah, some one of the prophets. Jesus said, "But who do you say that I am?" Because the fact of the matter is, the core of who you are is who I am. And you might change the way you do ministry, but you cannot forget who I am. Because the church changes, but I'm a changeless Christ. I'm the same today, yesterday, and forever. I'm 100% man, 100% God, and beside me there is no other. There is no other name by which men can be saved. Except the name of Jesus Christ. The other day in Florida, the school was shot up. I want you to understand something. Our world is changing. People are getting frustrated because the things we put our trust in are crumbling. The psalmist says, when the foundations are destroyed, what shall the righteous do? And I want you to understand something. We can pass all the gun legislation we want. The government cannot fix this. This is a sin problem. The schools cannot fix this. It's a sin problem. Yes, they need to make sure that AK-47 are not on the street. But when you take guns away, folk are going to stab. They're going to blow one another up. They're going to poison one another. Because it's the sin of the human heart. Jesus said the heart is desperately wicked. Who can know it? But God, the church. Now in ministry, in a changing world, and in changing circumstances, but we've got to resist the trend. We can't jump on everything. We can't just throw problems at something and think it's going to fix it. We've got to pray and see God's face and say, "God, what is your will for us in 2018. Don't panic to simply stay alive, but trust God to give us what we need.
Amen.
Then we've also, my brothers and sisters, got to remain faithful to Christ's call. We've got to move from an inward focus to an outward focus. You'll notice the front of our program says reaching beyond. That's an attempt to get us to not be so inward thinking, but to be outward thinking, to reach beyond our walls, to reach beyond where we are. Jesus, listen, he was facing steadfastly towards Jerusalem. Amen. And when Jesus announced this transition, it became a day of crisis for his human relationships. Listen, Jesus was a boy. He was in the temple, and he was teaching. It says he astounded the scribes and the Pharisees so much that at the age of 12, it says Jesus grew in favor with all men. He was popular. But now that Jesus starts to talk about dying on the cross, his popularity begins to wane. It begins to fade away. So much so that as Jesus, listen, in our text, as Jesus is literally trying to go to Jerusalem, the Bible says that he sent messengers on ahead of him to go into a village. And they went to the Samaritans, who were enemies of the church. And it said they didn't receive him because he was going to Jerusalem. It helps us to understand that there were the Samaritans and even those in the church. When Jesus said it's time for us to get back to doing what we're called to do, the Samaritans and the disciples didn't like what Jesus was talking about. Matter of fact, the disciples said, listen, if you're going to try to bring some change, stir change, and the Samaritans going to try to bring some change, we want you to bring down fire and get rid of anybody that's going to try to change what we already do. Jesus said, do you not know this is what I came for? This is the reason why I came to this hour. So then Jesus moved forward and said, listen, who wants to go with me on this journey? The first one that Jesus came to said, Lord, I'll follow you. The second one, Jesus didn't even wait for him to say, I'll follow. Jesus said, follow me. The third one said, Jesus, I'll follow you, but. Now, I think most of us fit in that third category. I will follow thee, but I got to know where we're going. I got to know how much it's going to cost. I got to know how much commitment it's going to be, how much it's going to change things, where we're going, how long it's going to take. Can I take everybody else with me? Somebody talk to me in this place. The fact is, Jesus asked the first one to follow him. Jesus responded by saying, do you know my lot in life? Because if you don't really understand my lot and my purpose in life, you don't need to follow me. Jesus said, if you suffer with me, you shall also reign with me. So he just comes to the second one. He don't let him say nothing. He simply says, follow me. And the man comes back with some excuses. But then the third one said, Lord, I will follow you, but let me first go and do this, that, and the other. Listen, the Lord wanted them to know all through chapter 9 that it's about transition. Here's how we know it's about transition. When you go to the beginning of chapter 9, if you look in your Bibles, it says in verses 3 and 4, Jesus said, pack light. That's what he said. He said, don't take a satchel, don't take a backpack. He said, travel light. Because we're going to be constantly on the move. We're not going to stay in one place. Matter of fact, when you go one place and they won't receive you, shake the dust and move someplace else. Lord said, listen, travel light. Because we got to keep moving. You can't have old baggage. You can't have old things holding you down. Travel light. Because I'm going to make you move at any moment in time. And when my voice says move, you got to be ready to move. Not only does he say travel light, get to verse 23 and 26. He says, whoever's not willing to deny himself and follow me is not worthy to take up my cross. What Jesus says here is, listen, if you're going to follow me, understand it's a one-way ticket. There's no turning back. It's a one-way ticket. It's not a round trip. Ain't no layover. It's a one-way ticket. We know where we're going. We're going to get there. If you're going to follow me, you're going to follow me, and ain't going to be no turning back. As a matter of fact, if you want to turn back before I get to verse 51. Because when I set my face toward Jerusalem, I need folk who are committed to go along with me. And the fact of the matter is, you got to make up in your mind, do you love the Lord for who he is or for what the Lord gives you? And when the church falls in love with Jesus for who he is once again, it'll be blessed. Okay. I like to get up early in the morning, not only to jog, but whenever I want to go to Walmart, Sand Springs, I want to get up early. The reason why I want to get up early, I want to beat the crowd. I want to get up there at 6 o'clock in the morning because it can get crowded in Walmart, and Walmart only have one lane open. And that's sure enough frustrating. One lane, so I get there early in the morning, 6 o'clock in the morning, and the parking lot is full. I said, what in the world is going on? I'm always here early. I always be crowded. Parking lot is crowded at 6 in the morning. What's going on? I go in. To my dismay, it is full of people. They running around grabbing stuff. I get the few things that I want. I realize it's going to take longer than I expected. I get in line. It takes forever. I'm trying to figure out why is it so crowded. I found out that everything was at a reduced price. And because everything was at a reduced price, everybody was in the store at 6 o'clock in the morning. On those other days when things are at regular price, ain't nobody there. And so as I stood in line frustrated, I realized, like these disciples, that's how many of us are. We want Jesus at a reduced price. As long as it don't cost nothing. As long as we ain't got a gift. As long as there's a free giveaway. We want Jesus at a reduced price. But Jesus said, here, I'm raising the stakes. It's going to cost you your life. And the crowd got small. The fact of the matter is, who loves the Lord? Who's committed to Christ at all costs? Because Christ was committed to you so much that he died on Calvary's cross. The Bible says that one Friday, he died. He didn't send somebody else to die. He died not for his sins, but for the sins of the whole world. That was commitment by Christ. Follow Christ. We can't follow him at reduced price. We got to be totally committed to the Lord. My brothers and my sisters, total commitment requires surrender of your soul and your life to Christ. And so as I open the doors of the church, I extend this invitation for your total commitment. Total commitment to Christ. Total commitment to his church that he died for. Amen. The deacons come as the ministers and I stand. We invite you to stand as we extend this invitation to become a follower of Christ, reminded of the commitment in our text that no man having put his hand to the plow and looking back is fit for the kingdom of God. Don't allow your old ways, don't allow any old baggage to hinder you from coming from the one who can change your eternal destiny. His name is Jesus. We invite you to come. Amen.